Hi, welcome to Power Electronics Lecture. This is a continuation for a series of lectures handling or covering the basics for power electronics. So today I'm going to talk about ideal and practical switches, the differences and how they turn on and off in different load cases, and also how we calculate the switching losses, because last time we covered the thermal consideration, which are maybe taking the account the power dissipation that translated to heat. And one cause for the power dissipation is the switching losses. So let's dive in. One of our earlier lectures, we covered the importance of higher efficiency. But we got a question how we achieve the higher efficiency. And the answer was by going through one of the two routes, selecting good switches enough to dissipate less heat and less power. And that selection, you should build some knowledge about the different types of diodes and transistors and thyristors, and also what the market offers by offering maybe different materials, silicon, silicon carbide, or GaN. And also you can go for higher efficiency by manipulating your topology, and maybe you should be aware about different topologies, various of topologies, and how they achieve interleaving or soft switching, and also how they use differences like switch capacitors, and go for hard and soft switching for some MOSFETs just to dissipate less heat and achieve higher efficiency. So today we are going to cover the general characteristics of switches, like the ideal one and the practical one, and how they switch on and off, and from where the dissipation, and how we calculate that. So in this lecture, when we say the switch means maybe diode or transistor or thyristor. So usually the switches can be controlled on and off by either active way and passive way. So the passive way means the switch state, means on and off, depends on the polarity of the voltage across its terminals or the current flowing through that. Okay, and one example is the diode. We have anode and we have cathode. It doesn't have a control signal. I can't actually apply any control signal to switch it on and off. It decides by itself, passively. If the voltage of the anode more than the voltage of the cathode by some voltage, it depends on the data sheet, so it will turn on. And once it turns on, that's it. It will conduct some current. So in that way, I can't say I control the conductivity of this diode. It controls by itself passively if the voltage of the anode more than the cathode, so that's why it's classified as uncontrolled. The other way to control the switches is by the active way. The switch state depends on the sum on some control signal applied on its terminals to control the conduction through it. And maybe we have different examples like the transistors, where we have the base and collector and emitter. And for the MOSFET, we have the gate and drain and source. So the collector to emitter, the conductivity or the current through that path will not be passively controlled. It will be controlled by the applied signal on the base. And similarly, will be controlled by the applied signal on the gate for the MOSFET. And also we have another example, which is the thyristor. Thyristor also is like a diode, exactly like a diode, anode and cathode and diode. But instead of depending on the voltage of the anode to turn on the diode, no, it will wait for me to give a pulse on the gate terminal. So on all of these examples, we have a third terminal that's waiting for a signal to be applied and then will conduct some current. But we have small differences between this group and this group. The first group, which is transistors, I can turn on and turn off the MOSFET or the BGT transistors by applying on signal and off signal. But for the thyristor, I can turn it on by applying a positive signal here, reference to the cathode, but I can't turn it off. So if I just make that signal disappear or I return it to zero, the thyristor will keep conducting until one of the conditions for switching it off applies here, okay? Like the voltage of the anode is less than the cathode, so it will switch off by itself. So I can turn it on, but I can't turn it off. So that's why this group is called fully controlled. I can turn it on and off, but the thyristor is semi-controlled, which I can turn on, but I can't turn it off. So these are the switches we have, but how different they are from the ideal switches. So this is the same for the ideal switch, and there is always some voltage will be dropped across the switch, and also some current will go through that switch. In the on state, where we have current going through the ideal switch, okay, that current will be maximum, okay? It doesn't have a limit if it's ideal. And the voltage in the on state, it should be zero. So that's why it can be manipulated or mimic like this. So the voltage is called voltage on, it should be zero. And the current in the on state, it should be infinity. For the off state, it's different. I think we should cut it off all. And the current here in the switch, it will be totally zero. And there is no leakage current. And the voltage between the terminals of the of the switch should handle the maximum voltage ever found, which is infinity. Okay, so this is just the ideal switch. It can handle infinite current if it's conducting and infinite voltage if it's not conducting. But what about the power dissipation during the turning on and off? So if it's on state, I think you will agree with me, the voltage across the switch will be zero. And if it's in the off state, the current will be zero. So if I multiply these values and to get the power dissipation, it will be all the time zero. Now, during the transition from off to on or from on to off, it should be instantaneous in the ideal switches. But in the practical switches, no, it goes as linear curve or linearly with the time, okay? So that's why we have instantaneous transition here that will also give the value of zero power dissipation. So I can call these two moments here as the switching losses. This is the switching on losses, and this is the switching off losses. And the conduction, where the conduction is during the on time, okay, where we have some current going, okay? So this is called the conduction, and also this is zero. So we have here some conduction losses and switching losses on and off. And it appears for us that in the ideal switch, we all have zero. So what is the total power dissipation by this switch? Ideally, it should be the losses for the switching on and off plus the conduction losses. But what about the practical one? The practical one is different. We have the transition between the off state and on state. It's not instantaneous for the current and also for the voltage. So for the ideal switch where we have some diodes or transistors, when it turn on, the voltage across the switch is not zero. So when it turns on here, in the ideal switch, the voltage on was zero, but here we have some value, like the saturation voltage, VCE sat, okay? Or the RDS resistance for the MOSFET times the current, it will drop some voltage across the drain and source. So all the time, the practical switches have some voltage drop across its terminals, and the current through any switch we know practically, it should have some limit. It doesn't accept any current, okay? And the voltage in the off state, it should be less than maximum voltage. So for each switch, we have maximum voltage that can handle. More than this, it will be damaged. And also the current will not be exactly zero in that offset because it has some leakage current, okay? So that's why all these considerations should be taken into account for practical switches. What about the power dissipation? As you see here, in the off state, we have nearly zero current, okay? Whatever the value of the voltage, it will be multiplied and the result will be zero. But here, we have in the on state, we have good current, okay? High or maximum current. But here we have still voltage drop across the terminals of my transistor or my switch, and that's called V on. And multiplying that high current by this voltage, even if small, it will dissipate the conduction losses, okay? And during the transition from off to on or on to off, we have linear relation here with the time. That means if I have at any moment some value for the current, I also will get some value for the voltage. Multiplying these values also will count for the power dissipation. And this is some approximation about the shape for the power dissipation or instantaneous power dissipation. So we have zero here and zero there in the off state, considering that the leakage current is zero. But we have here something like this for the power dissipation, and this is conduction losses, and this is another switching losses again. So in the first one here, we call it switching on losses, and the last one switching off losses, and also we have here conduction losses. The area under all these is called the energy, dissipated energy, okay? And if we divide it by the period for this switching, we will get the average power dissipation for this MOSFET. So the total power loss for this MOSFET or for this switch, it will be the switching losses and the conduction losses. And now we will cover how we calculate these switching losses. So we will take one of the cases where we have resistor, and we are switching that resistor by a transistor, whatever the transistor, BGT, MOSFET, or IGBT, by some gate signal here. And we got some sketch here, okay? So we have off to on to off, and the voltage and current waveforms will be like this. So let's now just have a look what happens practically. So when I turn on my MOSFET by applying some voltage across the gate terminal here, and we have the signal on the gate like that, the transistor now will take action to turn on. But that action will have some time delay, and that delay is called TD, to start dropping the voltage and maybe rising the current, for example. And that time delay time is based on the capacitance of the junction, because we have PN junction and that has a small capacitance to be charged. And for also the MOSFET, it depends on the threshold voltage and also the gain for the MOSFET to act this action or to act on this command for the turning on. So we have some delay here, and also we have some falling voltage time or rising current time, okay? That also takes time because it doesn't occur instantaneously. So all these two are the turn on time. And then we will go to the on state where we have V on, so it's not zero. There is some voltage drop across my transistor here, and the current will be maximum. And then once I give the command for turning off, it also has some delay, and that delay is called TS. It's not TD, it's TS. That TS is saturation time or the storage time, because we already accumulated lots of charges in the junction or the channel, and we want to deplete and remove these charges, and that takes time. That time taken is called the storage or saturation time. And then we have falling for the current and rising for the voltage, and then the transition will finish, and that's called turn off. So this is what happens, and the data for the TD and rise time and fall time and TS is obtained from the data sheet. And again, for the power dissipation, I think you see with me that we have linear transition for the voltage and also the current. When we multiply them to get the instantaneous power, I think we will get something like this. In the off state, it's zero. In the transition between off to on, we have a spike here for the power dissipation. And also we go to the conduction losses, okay? And then another peak here for the power dissipation during the off switching, okay? So we have on switching and off switching, power dissipation, and also we have the conduction. So our job now is to calculate the switching losses, because the conduction losses is easy to be calculated if we consider the previous lectures, because we have covered that before. And to make the calculation easy for us, we will consider linear approximation for this curve, okay? And we will consider this curve here. So it will be like a triangle, okay? And that triangle is easy to be maybe calculated and integrated, and we can consider the switching losses equation as approximation of what's happening in practical. So again, my voltage is dropping and my current is going up, okay, in the on state, and the opposite is happening in the off state. So now let's consider we have a resistive load, because in the inductive load is totally different, okay? So let's start with this. We can really get the equation for the current, which is a line here, and the voltage, which is a line here, okay, and multiply them by each other. So during the this transition, we have the voltage equation as V maximum minus V maximum T divided by T on. And I think you know how to get this by math module, and also we covered that before, okay? This is for the voltage. By for the current is I maximum divided by T on as a function of T. So by multiplying these together, we will get the instantaneous power. And by integrating that instantaneous power, we'll get the energy dissipation, the dissipated energy during the on state here, okay? But if we care about the average power, we have to get that integration over one duration, which is the period, okay? So now we got the average power, okay, as V maximum, I maximum, times T on multiplied by F divided by 6. Why is multiplied by F? Because if I want to get that integration for one period, it will be 0 to T, okay? And I will divide it by T, so it will be multiplied by 1 over T. 1 over T is the same as multiplication of the frequency, okay? So I multiplied by the frequency. If you are interested, you can conduct the integration for this part over one period and divide it by T, and you will get the power dissipation during the on time. And I think you will agree with me that off time will be similar if we consider the equation for the current and voltage, and also it will equal the same thing. But this one is during the on time, and that one during the off time. So what is the power dissipation for the switching? It will be Vm, Im, and we have turn on and turn off, so we combine turn on and off, and also multiply by frequency divided by 6. This is the equation that you are going to use in your calculation. Remember this one. So now we calculated the switching losses for the transistor if it's driving a resistive load. But what happens if it's inductive load? In the inductive load, it's different. Why? Because the transition of the voltage and current different from the resistive case. We have here the voltage, okay, of the across the transistor here, okay, and we have the current. So when we have an inductive load, the inductive load always resists the change in current. That means if we assume there is a current here going through that load, which is, for example, 10 ampere, okay? That 10 ampere has here at this junction two paths to go. Either in the diode and circulate, if the switch is off, and if the switch is on, it will go through the transistor, okay? So we have here some current which is going through that load that will be continuously flowing through that inductor. So that 10 ampere, sometimes like this, and sometimes like that to the ground, okay? So it depends on if the switch is on and off. But this is not as easy as what I described, because if I want to turn on and off that transistor, this point here, okay, it will be dictated by the diode, okay? If the diode is on, so that voltage here will be very close to the VS, okay? That makes the diode conducting longer time than we expect. And also happens if it's opposite. I will explain that now. So if we have off state, the off state now we have no current and we have maximum voltage. So at this point here, we have maximum voltage. And the current in the transistor, in the inductor, is going through that diode like that. What happens if the current goes through the diode? The diode is already conducting, and it will drop small voltage across it. That voltage will be ideally zero, okay? So it will be like a wire, okay, between the VS and that point here, okay? And actually, it will be higher voltage, because the voltage of the VS, it will be added to the voltage across that diode, and it will be here higher voltage. It's higher voltage to keep the diode forward bias, okay? That's in the consideration if this is off, okay? So the current is going like that, okay, for some time until the transistor decides to turn on. Now the transistor decided now to turn on and go to the switching, the on state. Now we have two states, one for the current and one for the voltage. The current now starts finding another way to go down to the ground. But what happens to the voltage? The voltage is still dictated and controlled by this diode. The diode doesn't turn off once this transistor turns on. That current now, it was going like that. Now it will partially it will go through the transistor and partially will go through that diode. So the diode is still on, even if this one is turned on. Okay. And if the diode is on again, the VS will be present at this point for some time longer than the expected. So that's why we have the voltage maximum across this transistor here is extended a little bit beyond, okay? At that time, the current has reached its maximum. So to make this diode turn off now and the full current should go through the transistor, we have to pass more current here, more current here, more current here, until we get the transistor, the diode has no current to conduct, and at that point, this voltage will not be able to forward bias this diode and will turn off the diode, and all the 10 ampere or the current will go through the transistor. This is very important. So the cause of this delay is this voltage with the diode that is forward biased for longer time than we expect. So in the on state, we have the full current of that inductor is going through the transistor, okay, and releasing some conduction losses now because the voltage of the switch is not exactly zero. It has some voltage across the terminal. But now going to the off state, because the same, the current through the load will be continuous, okay, and it will find now no way to go through the transistor if I switch it off. So the current now will start decreasing here, but it has to go through another path. And that one is not turned on yet. So what will happen? The voltage at this point starts increasing, okay? And that increase will be able to turn on that diode, okay? And once it turns on, some current will go now through that diode, okay? But now the voltage already spiked to turn on, okay? So that's why we have the voltage here, the black curve, is already has come to the maximum very quickly because of the action of that of the inductor. Once we want to reduce the current, it will resist that by generating some voltage, and that voltage here was able to turn on that diode and then passing the transistor and passing the current. But that happened after the voltage has already reached the maximum. So the voltage will reach the maximum and the current then will decrease later on, okay? So here is the difference between the resistive and inductive load. The resistive load has no problem. It doesn't actually keep the same current all the time and it doesn't have a problem changing that instantaneously. But the inductive, no, it keeps it, and this diode, what it makes that delay for the voltage and also that spike and that delay for the current as well. So that's why we have different shapes of power dissipation. I have included here some explanation for you to read and to confirm the explanation that I have here, okay? So I will leave it for you. And also for the power dissipation, we have a little bit bigger area for the switching losses, okay, if we compare it with the resistive load. So now let's have a look at how we calculate the switching losses for inductive load. So as we have done in the resistive load, we will consider that we have linear equation for the current. And look at this time here. We have linear equation for the current, okay? But we have fixed value for the voltage. And in the second part of the on state, we have linear decay here for the voltage and constant current. So we can consider the turn on as two duration T1 and T2. In T1, we have voltage constant and varying current. And in the T2, we have constant current and varying voltage. So we can get the equation for T1 for the voltage and current, and also for the T2 for the voltage and current. And to get the power dissipation in the on time, okay, we have to integrate these two, the multiplication for this one for the T1 and multiplication for this one over T2. And after doing this integration, we can get the equation for the energy dissipation. But that T1 and T2 here in that term, T1 and T2, it's exactly the same as T on. So we just make it T on equals this term here. And we know the frequency is 1 over T. I don't want the energy dissipation. I want the power dissipation. Okay. So that's why we just divided by T, which is the same as multiplying by F. Okay. And this is the final equation for the turn on switching losses. Okay. Similarly, we can get the turn off. And then finally, we can get the total power dissipation for the turn on and also turn off by this equation. So it's V maximum, which is the maximum voltage, times the current maximum, it's not the average, times the T on plus T off time, plus times the frequency over 2. We have the same equation exactly for the resistive, but it was divided over 6. So we have here the two equations, the resistive load, okay, we have this equation, and inductive load, this equation. By looking at these two, we find that the resistive load makes the transistor or the switch dissipating less power because it's divided by 6 rather than dividing by 2 here. So the first conclusion is the switching losses is a load dependent. Okay, if it's resistive, it will be divided by 6. If it's inductive, it will be divided by 2. And the second thing is inductive load switching losses, it will be 3 times the resistive one, because here we have divided by 6, but this one by 2. So this one is bigger than this one by 3. Okay. And the third thing is the peak value for the power dissipation, instantaneous power dissipation. So instantaneous power dissipation, the peak value happened here, okay? When we have half of the V maximum, it's here at this point, where we have half of the V maximum and also half of the I maximum. So if I multiplied half V maximum times half I maximum, I will get the peak value here as quarter the multiplication of V maximum, I maximum. But look at the peak here. The peak here is happening at that point where we have maximum I and maximum V approximately. Okay, so the peak value here is V maximum times I maximum. So this one is a quarter, and this one is V max, I max. That means the power dissipation, peak power dissipation, is 4 times more for the inductive case. So the peak power, instantaneous one, is 4 times greater. And if we got the values here again, so it's a quarter V maximum, I maximum, but this one is V maximum, I maximum. That's why you have to be careful when you design and you select your MOSFET or your switch, and also to consider your load in the calculation. So this brings me to the end of this part of this lecture, and in the coming video I will cover the ALTI spice and how we use it to validate what we got here.